Light on Masonry. Note, the first 3 degrees in Masonry here published are as written by Captain William Morgan, and as conferred in the lodges in the western part of New York. A description of the ceremonies used in opening a lodge of entered apprentice Masons, which is the same in all the upper degrees, with the exception of the difference in the signs, due guards, grips, pass grips, words and their several names, all of which will be given and explained in their proper places as the work progresses. One rap calls the lodge to order, one calls up the junior and senior deacons, two raps call up the subordinate officers, and three, all the members of the lodge. The master having called the lodge to order, and the officers all seated, the master says to the junior warden, "Brother Junior, are they all entered apprentice masons in the South?" Answer? "They are, worshipful." Master to the senior warden, "Brother Senior, are they all entered apprentice masons in the West?" Answer? "They are, worshipful." The master then says, "They are in the East." At the same time he gives a rap with the common gavel or mallet, which calls up both deacons. Master to junior deacon, "Attend to that part of your duty, and inform the tiler that we are about to open a lodge of entered apprentice masons, and direct him to tell her accordingly." The tiler then steps to the door and gives 3 raps, which are answered by 3 from without. The junior deacon then gives 1, which is also answered by the tiler with 1. The door is then partly opened, and the junior deacon delivers his message, and resumes his situation, and says, "The door is tiled, worshipful," at the same time giving the due guard, which is never omitted when the master is addressed, the master to the junior deacon, "By whom?" Answer? "By a master mason without the door, armed with the proper implements of his office." Master to the junior deacon, "His duty there." Answer? "To keep off all cowards and eavesdroppers, see that none pass or repass without permission from the master." Some say without permission from the chair, master to junior deacon, "Brother Junior, your place in the lodge." Answer? "At the right hand of the senior warden in the West." Master to junior deacon, "Your business there, Brother Junior." Answer? "To wait on the worshipful master and wardens, act as their proxy in the active duties of the lodge, and take charge of the door." Master to junior deacon, "The senior deacon's place in the lodge." Answer? "At the right hand of the worshipful master in the East." The master, while asking the last question, gives 2 raps, which calls up all the subordinate officers. Master to senior deacon, "Your duty there, Brother Senior." Answer? "To wait on the worshipful master and wardens, act as their proxy in the active duties of the lodge, attend to the preparation and introduction of candidates, and welcome and clothe all visiting brethren, i.e. furnish them with an apron." Master to senior deacon, "The secretary's place in the lodge, Brother Senior." Answer? "At the left hand of the worshipful master in the East." Master to secretary, "Your duty there, Brother Secretary." Answer? "The better to observe the worshipful master's will and pleasure, record the proceedings of the lodge, transmit a copy of the same to the Grand Lodge, if required, receive all monies and money bills from the hand of the brethren, pay them over to the treasurer, and take his receipt for the same." The master to the secretary, "The treasurer's place in the lodge." Answer? "At the right hand of the worshipful master." Master to treasurer, "Your duty there, Brother Treasurer." Answer? "Duly to observe the worshipful master's will and pleasure, receive all monies and money bills from the hands of the secretary, keep a just and true account of the same, pay them out by order of the worshipful master and consent of the brethren." The master to the treasurer, "The junior warden's place in the lodge, Brother Treasurer." Answer? "In the South, worshipful." Master to junior warden, "Your business there, Brother Junior." Answer? "As the sun in the south at high meridian, is the beauty and glory of the day, so stands the junior warden in the south, the better to observe the time, call the crafts from labor to refreshment, superintend them during the hours thereof, see that none convert the hours of refreshment into that of intemperance or excess, and call them on again in due season, that the worshipful master may have honor, and they pleasure and profit thereby." Master to the junior warden, "The senior warden's place in the lodge." Answer? "In the West, worshipful." Master to the senior warden, "Your duty there, Brother Senior." Answer? "As the sun sets, in the West, to close the day, so stands the senior warden in the West, to assist the worshipful master in opening his lodge, take care of the jewels and implements, see that none be lost, pay the craft their wages, if any did you, and see that none go away dissatisfied. Master to the senior warden, the master's place in the lodge. Answer? In the east, worshipful. Master to the senior warden, his duty there. Answer? As the sun rises in the east to open and adorn the day, so presides the worshipful master in the east to open and adorn his lodge, set his crafts to work with good and wholesome laws, or cause the same to be done. The master now gives three raps, when all the brethren rise, and the master, taking off his hat, proceeds as follows, in like manner so do I, strictly forbidding all profane language, private committees, or any other disorderly conduct whereby the peace and harmony of this lodge may be interrupted while engaged in its lawful pursuits, under no less penalty than the bylaws, or such penalty as a majority of the brethren present may see fit to inflict. Brethren, attend to giving the signs. Here lodges differ very much. In some they declare the lodge open as follows, before they give the signs, the master, all the brethren imitating him, extends his left arm from his body so as to form an angle of about 45 degrees, and holds his right hand transversely across his left, the palms thereof 1 inch apart. This is called the first sign of a Mason, is the sign of distress in this degree, and alludes to the position a candidate's hands are placed in when he takes the obligation of an entered apprentice Mason. The master then draws his right hand across his throat, the hand open, with the thumb next to the throat, and drops it down by his side. This is called the due guard of an entered apprentice Mason, many call it the sign, and alludes to the penalty of an obligation. See obligation, the master then declares the lodge opened, in the following manner, I now declare this lodge of entered apprentice Masons duly opened for the dispatch of business. The senior warden declares it to the junior warden, and he to the brethren. Come, brethren, let us pray. One of the following prayers is used. Most holy and glorious God, the great architect of the universe, the giver of all good gifts and graces, thou hast promised that where two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt be in the midst of them, and bless them. In thy name we assemble, most humbly beseeching thee to bless us in all our undertakings, that we may know and serve thee aright, and that all our actions may tend to thy glory, and our advancement in knowledge and virtue. And we beseech thee, O Lord God, to bless our present assembling, and to illumine our minds through the influence of the Sun of Righteousness, that we may walk in the light of thy countenance, and when the trials of our probationary state are over, be admitted into the temple not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Amen. So mote it be. Another prayer, as often used at opening as closing. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, it is like the precious ointment upon the head that run down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garment, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, evermore. Amen. So mote it be. The lodge being now open and ready to proceed to business, the master directs the secretary to read the minutes of the last meeting, which naturally brings to view the business of the present. If there are any candidates to be brought forward, that will be the first business attended to. I will, therefore, proceed with the description of the ceremonies used in the admission and initiation of a candidate in the first degree of Masonry. A person wishing to become a Mason must get someone who is a Mason to present his petition to a lodge, when, if there are no serious objections, it will be entered on the minutes, and a committee of two or three appointed to inquire into his character, and report to the next regular communication. The following is the form of a petition used by a candidate, but a worthy candidate will not be rejected for the want of formality in his petition. To the worshipful Master Wardens and Brethren of Lodge No. Of Free and Accepted Masons. The subscriber, residing in, of lawful age, and by occupation A, begs leave to state that, unbiased by friends, and uninfluenced by mercenary motives, he freely and voluntarily offers himself a candidate for the mysteries of Masonry, and that he is prompt to solicit this privilege by a favorable opinion conceived of the institution, a desire of knowledge and a sincere wish of being serviceable to his fellow creatures. Should his petition be granted, he will cheerfully conform to all the ancient established usages and customs of the fraternity. Signed. A.B. At the next regular communication, if no very serious objection appears against the candidate, the ballot boxes will be passed, one black ball will reject a candidate. The boxes may be passed three times. The deacons are the proper persons to pass them. One of the boxes has black and white beans, or balls in it, the other empty. The one with the balls in it goes before, and furnishes each member with a black and white ball. The empty box follows and receives them. There are two holes in the top of his box with a small tube, generally, in each, one of which is black, and the other white, with a partition in the box. The members put both their balls into this box as their feelings dictate. When the balls are received, the box is presented to the master, senior, and junior wardens, who pronounce clear or not clear, as the case may be. The ballot proving clear, the candidate, if present, is conducted into a small preparation room adjoining the lodge. He is asked the following questions, and gives the following answers. Senior deacon to candidate, do you sincerely declare, upon your honor before these gentlemen, that, unbiased by friends, uninfluenced by unworthy motives, you freely and voluntarily offer yourself a candidate for the mysteries of Masonry? Answer? I do. Senior deacon to candidate, do you sincerely declare, upon your honor before these gentlemen, that you are prompt to solicit the privileges of Masonry, by a favorable opinion conceived of the institution, a desire of knowledge, and a sincere wish of being serviceable to your fellow creatures? Answer? I do. Senior deacon to candidate. Note. The reader will here learn one reason why those who enter a lodge, never come out, until they have taken a degree. The candidate is made to promise upon his honor that he will conform to all the ancient established usages and customs of the fraternity, hence let him be ever so much opposed to the ceremonies of initiation, or the oath of the degree, he cannot go back, for he feels bound by his promise. Should he, however, feel constrained to violate his word, the persuasions, and, if necessary, the threats of the master and brethren compel him to go forward. Do you sincerely declare, upon your honor before these gentlemen, that you will cheerfully conform to all the ancient established usages and customs of the fraternity? Answer? I do. After the above questions are proposed and answered, and the result reported to the master, he says, Brethren, at the request of Mr. A. B., he has been proposed and accepted in regular form. I therefore recommend him as a proper candidate for the mysteries of Masonry, and worthy to partake of the privileges of the fraternity, and in consequence of a declaration of his intentions, voluntarily made, I believe he will cheerfully conform to the rules of the order. The candidate, during the time, is divested of all his apparel, shirt excepted, and furnished with a pair of drawers, kept in the lodge for the use of candidates. The candidate is then blindfolded, his left foot bare, his right in a slipper, his left breast and arm naked, and a rope called a cable tow round his neck and left arm. The rope is not put round the arm in all lodges, in which posture the candidate is conducted to the doorway he is caused to give, or the conductor gives three distinct knocks, which are answered by three from within. The conductor gives one more, which is also answered by one from within. The door is then partly opened, and the junior deacon generally asks, Who comes there? Who comes there? Who comes there? The conductor, alias the senior deacon, answers, A poor blind candidate who has long been desirous of having and receiving a part of the rights and benefits of this worshipful lodge dedicated, some say erected, to God and held forth to the holy order of Saint John, as all true fellows and brothers have done, who have gone this way before him. The junior deacon then asks, Is it of his own free will and accord he makes this request? Is he duly and truly prepared? Worthy and well qualified? And properly avouched for? All of which being answered in the affirmative, the junior deacon to senior deacon, by what further rights does he expect to obtain this benefit? Answer? A. Being a man, free-born, of lawful age, and under the tongue of good report. The junior deacon then says, Since this is the case, you will wait till the worshipful master in the east is made acquainted with his request, and his answer returned. The junior deacon repairs to the master, when the same questions are asked and answers returned as at the door, after which, the master says, Since he comes endowed with all these necessary qualifications, let him enter this worshipful lodge in the name of the Lord and take heed on what he enters. The candidate then enters, the junior deacon at the same time pressing his naked left breast with the point of the compass, and asks the candidate, Did you feel anything? Answer? I did, junior deacon to candidate, what was it? Answer? A torture. The junior deacon then says, As this is a torture to your flesh, so may it ever be to your mind and conscience, if ever you should attempt to reveal the secrets of Masonry unlawfully. The candidate is then conducted to the center of the lodge, where he and the senior deacon kneels, and the deacon says the following prayer. Vouchsafe thine aid, Almighty Father of the universe, to this our present convention, and grant that candidate for masonry may dedicate and devote his life to thy service, and become a true and faithful brother among us. Endue him with a competency of thy divine wisdom, that by the secrets of our art, he may be the better enabled to display the beauties of holiness, to the honor of thy holy name. So mote it be. Amen. The master then asks the candidate, in whom do you put your trust? Answer? In God. The master then takes him by the right hand and says, since in God you put your trust, arise, follow your leader and fear no danger. The senior deacon then conducts the candidate three times regularly round the lodge, and halts at the junior warden in the south, where the same questions are asked and answers returned as at the door. As the candidate and the conductor are passing round the room, the master reads the following passage of scripture, and takes the same time to read it that they do to go round the lodge three times. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head, that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garment, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life for evermore. The candidate is then conducted to the senior warden in the west, where the same questions are asked and answers returned as before. From thence he is conducted to the worshipful master in the east, where the same questions are asked and answers returned as before. The master likewise demands of him, from whence he came and whither he is travelling. The candidate answers, from the west and travelling to the east. Master inquires, why do you leave the west and travel to the east? Answer? In search of light. Master then says, since the candidate is travelling in search of light, you will please conduct him back to the west from whence he came, and put him in the care of the senior warden, who will teach him how to approach the east, the place of light, by advancing upon one upright regular step, to the first step, his feet forming the right angle of an oblong square, his body erect at the altar before the master, and place him in a proper position to take upon him the solemn oath or obligation of an entered apprentice mason. The senior warden receives the candidate, and instructs him as directed. He first steps off with the left foot and brings up the heel of the right into the hollow thereof. The heel of the right foot against the ankle of the left will of course form the right angle of an oblong square. The candidate then kneels on his left knee, and places his right foot as to form a square with the left. He turns his foot round until the ankle bone is as much in front of him as the toes on the left. The candidate's left hand is then put under the Holy Bible, square and compass, and the right hand on them. This is the position in which a candidate is placed when he takes upon him the oath or obligation of an entered apprentice mason. As soon as the candidate is placed in this position, the worshipful master approaches him, and says, Mr. A. B., you are now placed in a proper position to take upon you the solemn oath or obligation of an entered apprentice mason. Note. In many lodges this is put in the form of a question, thus, are you willing to take an obligation upon you that does not affect your politics or religion? The promise to conform, made before entering the lodge, the assurance that the oath is not to interfere with their political or religious principles, and the manner the obligation is administered, only two or three words being repeated at a time, consequently not fully understood, are among the reasons which have led many great and good men to take oaths incompatible with the laws of God and our country. Which I assure you is neither to affect your religion nor politics. If you are willing to take it, repeat your name and say after me. And although many have refused to take any kind of an obligation, and begged for the privilege of retiring, yet none have made their escape, they have been either coerced, or persuaded to submit. There are thousands who never return to the lodge after they are initiated. The following obligation is then administered. I. A. B. Of my own free will and accord, in presence of Almighty God and this worshipful lodge of free and accepted Masons, dedicated to God and held forth to the holy order of Saint John, do hereby and hereon most solemnly and sincerely promise and swear, that I will always hail, ever conceal, and never reveal any part, or parts, art, or arts, point, or points of the secrets, arts and mysteries of ancient Freemasonry, which I have received, am about to receive, or may hereafter be instructed in, to any person or persons in the known world, except it be a true and lawful brother Mason, or within the body of a just and lawfully constituted lodge of such, and not unto him, nor unto them whom I shall hear so to be, but unto him and them only whom I shall find so to be, after strict trial and due examination or lawful information. Furthermore, do I promise and swear that I will not write, print, stamp, stain, hew, cut, carve, indent, paint, or engrave it on anything movable or immovable, under the whole canopy of heaven, whereby, or whereon the least letter, figure, character, mark, stain, shadow, or resemblance of the same may become legible or intelligible to myself or any other person in the known world, whereby the secrets of Masonry may be unlawfully obtained through my unworthiness. To all which I do most solemnly and sincerely promise and swear, without the least equivocation, mental reservation, or self-evasion of mind in me whatever, binding myself under no less penalty, than to have my throat cut across, my tongue torn out by the roots, and my body buried in the rough sands of the sea at low water mark, where the tide ebbs and flows twice in 24 hours, so help me God, and keep me steadfast in the due performance of the same. Note. It is frequently said by Masons that the penalties of Masonic oaths are nothing, that no one is bound to inflict them, and that if Morgan was put to death by Masons it was not done in conformity to Masonic law. But if one part of the oath is nothing, another part is nothing by the same rule. Any Mason, therefore, is at liberty to reveal Masonry without exposing himself any more than he would if the oath was never administered. But if the penalties are not to be inflicted, why did they kill Morgan, and why is a Mason sworn that he will use his most decided endeavors, by the blessing of God, to bring such person, the person who violates Masonic law, to the most strict and condign punishment agreeable to the ancient rules and usages of the fraternity? After the obligation, the master addresses the candidate in the following manner: Brother, to you the secrets of Masonry are about to be unveiled, and a brighter sun never shone, luster on your eyes, while prostrate before this sacred altar, do you not shudder at every crime? Have you not confidence in every virtue? May these thoughts ever inspire you with the most noble sentiments, may you ever feel that elevation of soul, that shall scorn a dishonest act. Brother, what do you most desire? Answer? Light. Master to brethren, brethren, stretch forth your hands and assist in bringing this new-made brother from darkness to light. The members having formed a circle round the candidate, the master says, And God said, Let there be light, and there was light. At the same time, all the brethren clap their hands, and stamp on the floor with their right foot as heavy as possible, the bandage dropping from the candidate's eyes at the same instant, which, after having been so long blind, and full of fearful apprehensions all the time, this great and sudden transition from perfect darkness to a light brighter, if possible, than the meridian sun in a midsummer day, sometimes produces an alarming effect. I once knew a man to faint on being brought to light, and his recovery was quite doubtful for some time. However, he did come to, but he never returned to the lodge again. I have often conversed with him on the subject. He is yet living, and will give a certificate in support of the above statement at any time if requested. After the candidate is brought to light, the master addresses him as follows: Brother, on being brought to light, you first discover three great lights in Masonry by the assistance of three lesser. They are thus explained: The three great lights in Masonry are the Holy Bible, square and compass. Note, the Holy Bible is here said to be given to Masons as a rule and guide for their faith and practice. But I would ask, if Freemasonry is the same among all nations, as is declared by Masonic writers, how this is possible, when it is a well-known fact, that but a small part of the human family are in possession of, or know anything about, the Bible. And if the Bible is received by Masons as a rule of faith and practice, why do they use a square and compass? Is not the Bible sufficient? The truth is, Masonry is not the same among all nations, only in some respects, and these are the fundamental principles of the order. The appendages of the institution differ according to the peculiar feelings and sentiments of the people among whom it exists. Hence in America, in a religious point of view, it has existed with difficulty. Masonic writers have been at a loss what to say on the subject, and in their extremity, one has called it religion, another the handmaid of religion, a third the twin sister of Christianity, and a fourth that it was simply an institution of morality and benevolence. To please the Christian, the Bible is introduced; to satisfy the infidel, the square and compass are added, the name of Christ is expunged from passages quoted, and the work of the Holy Ghost rejected, and all done in such a manner, that but few see the foul and monstrous imposition. The Holy Bible is given to us as a rule and guide for our faith and practice, the square, to square our actions, and the compass to keep us in due bounds with all mankind, but more especially with the brethren. The three lesser lights are three burning tapers, or candles placed on candlesticks, some say, or candles on pedestals. They represent the sun, moon, and master of the lodge, and are thus explained. As the sun rules the day and the moon governs the night, so ought the worshipful master with equal regularity to rule and govern his lodge, or cause the same to be done. You next discover me as master of this lodge, approaching you from the east upon the first step of masonry, under the sign and due guard of an entered apprentice mason. The sign and due guard has been explained. This is the manner of giving them. Imitate me as near as you can, keeping your position. First, step off with your left foot and bring the heel of the right into the hollow thereof so as to form a square. This is the first step in masonry. The following is the sign of an entered apprentice mason, and is the sign of distress in this degree. You are not to give it unless in distress. It is given by holding your two hands transversely across each other, the right hand upwards and 1 inch from the left. The following is the due guard of an entered apprentice mason. This is given by drawing your right hand across your throat, the thumb next to your throat, your arm as high as the elbow in a horizontal position. Brother, I now present you my right hand in token of brotherly love and esteem, and with it the grip and name of the grip of an entered apprentice mason. The right hands are joined together, as in shaking hands, and each sticks his thumb nail into the third joint or upper end of the forefinger. The name of the grip is Boaz, and is to be given in the following manner and no other. The master first gives the grip and word, and divides it for the instruction of the candidate. The questions are as follows. The master and candidate holding each other by the grip as before described. The master says, "What is this?" Answer: "A grip." Question: "A grip of what?" Answer: "The grip of an entered apprentice mason." Question: "Has it a name?" Answer: "It has." Question: "Will you give it to me?" Answer: "I did not so receive it, neither can I so impart it." Question: "What will you do with it?" Answer: "Letter it or halve it." Question: "Halve it and begin." Answer: "You begin." Question: "Begin you?" Answer: "Bow?" Question: "As?" Answer: "Boaz." Master says, "Right, brother Boaz, I greet you. It is the name of the left-hand pillar of the porch of King Solomon's temple. Arise, brother Boaz, and salute the junior and senior wardens as such, and convince them that you have been regularly initiated as an entered apprentice mason, and have got the sign, grip, and word." The master returns to his seat while the wardens are examining the candidate, and gets a lambskin or white apron, presents it to the candidate and observes, "Frother, I now present you with a lambskin or white apron. It is an emblem of innocence, and the badge of a mason. It has been worn by kings, princes, and potentates of the earth, who have never been ashamed to wear it. It is more honorable than the diadems of kings, or pearls of princesses, when worthily worn. It is more ancient than the golden fleece or Roman eagle, more honorable than the star and garter, or any other order that can be conferred upon you at this, or any other time, except it be in the body of a just and fully constituted lodge. You will carry it to the senior warden in the west, who will teach you how to wear it as an entered apprentice mason." The senior warden ties the apron on and turns up the flap instead of letting it fall down in front of the top of the apron. This is the way entered apprentice masons wear, or ought to wear, their aprons until they are advanced. The candidate is now conducted to the master in the east, who says, "Brother, as you are dressed, it is necessary you should have tools to work with. I will now present you with the working tools of an entered apprentice mason, which are the 24-inch gauge and common gavel." They are thus explained. The 24-inch gauge is an instrument made use of by operative masons to measure and lay out their work, but we as free and accepted masons make use of it for the more ignoble and glorious purpose of dividing our time. The 24 inches on the gauge are emblematical of the 24 hours in the day, which we are taught to divide into three equal parts, whereby we find 8 hours for the service of God, and a worthy distressed brother, 8 hours for our usual vocations, and 8 for refreshment and sleep. The common gavel is an instrument made use of by operative mason to break off the corners of rough stones, the better to fit them for the builder's use, but we as free and accepted masons use it for the more noble and glorious purpose of divesting our hearts and consciences of all the vices and superfluities of life, thereby fitting our minds as living and lively stones for that spiritual building, that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Note. let it no longer be said that Masonry is not a religious institution. But while we assert that it inculcates a system of religion, we affirm that it is not the religion of Jesus. There are in the world many religions, but all are false save one, and that is, of the Bible. Any system which professedly teaches a way to heaven, is a system of religion, but that which points out a path, without a crucified Savior and the sanctifying influences of the Holy Comforter, is not only false, but in direct hostility, to the true God, and the souls of men. Such a religious system, is that of Masonry. I also present you with a new name, it is caution, it teaches you as you are barely instructed in the rudiments of Masonry, that you should be cautious over all your words and actions, particularly when before the enemies of Masonry. I shall next present you with three precious jewels, which are a listening ear, a silent tongue, and a faithful heart. A listening ear teaches you to listen to the instructions of the worshipful master, but more especially that you should listen to the cries of a worthy distressed brother. A silent tongue teaches you to be silent while in the lodge, that the peace and harmony thereof may not be disturbed, but more especially, that you should be silent before the enemies of Masonry, that the raft may not be brought into disrepute by your imprudence. A faithful heart teaches you to be faithful to the instructions of the worshipful master at all times, but more especially, that you should be faithful and keep and conceal the secrets of Masonry, and those of a brother when given to you in charge as such, that they may remain as secure and inviolable in your breast as in his own, before communicated to you. I further present you with Czech words too, their names are Truth and Union, and are thus explained. Truth is a divine attribute, and the foundation of every virtue, to be good and true, is the first lesson we are taught in Masonry. On this theme we contemplate, and by its dictates endeavor to regulate our conduct. Hence, while influenced by this principle, hypocrisy and deceit are unknown among us, sincerity and plain dealing distinguish us, and the heart and tongue join in promoting each other's welfare, and rejoicing in each other's prosperity. Union is that kind of friendship, which ought to appear conspicuous in every Mason's conduct. It is so closely allied to the divine attribute, truth, that he who enjoys the one, is seldom destitute of the other. Should interest, honor, prejudice, or human depravity, ever induce you to violate any part of the sacred trust we now repose in you, let these two important words, at the earliest insinuation, teach you to put on the check line of truth, which will infallibly direct you to pursue that straight and narrow path which ends in the full enjoyment of the Grand Lodge above, where we shall all meet as Masons and members in the same family, in peace, harmony, and love, where all discord on account of politics, religion, or private opinion shall be unknown, and banished from within our walls. Brother, it has been a custom from time immemorial to demand, or ask from a newly made brother something of a metallic kind, not so much on account of its intrinsic value, but that it may be deposited in the archives of the lodge, as a memorial that you was herein made a Mason. A small trifle will be sufficient, anything of a metallic kind will do. If you have no money, anything of a metallic nature will be sufficient, even a button will do. The candidate says he has nothing about him, it is known he has nothing, search yourself, the master replies. He is assisted in searching, nothing is found, perhaps you can borrow a trifle, says the master. He tries to borrow, none will lend him, he proposes to go into the other room where his clothes are, he is not permitted. If a stranger, he is very much embarrassed, master to candidate, brother, let this ever be a striking lesson to you, and teach you, if you should ever see a friend, but more especially a brother in a like penniless situation, to contribute as liberally to his relief as his situation may require, and your abilities will admit without material injury to yourself or family. Master to senior deacon, you will conduct the candidate back from whence he came, and invest him of what he has been divested, and let him return for further instruction. A zealous attachment to these principles will ensure public and private esteem. In the state, you are to be a quiet and peaceable subject, true to your government and just to your country. You are not to countenance disloyalty, but faithfully submit to legal authority, and conform with cheerfulness to the government of the country in which you live. In your outward demeanor be particularly careful to avoid censure or reproach. Although your frequent appearance at our regular meetings is earnestly solicited, yet it is not meant that Masonry should interfere with your necessary vocations, for these are on no account to be neglected, neither are you to suffer your zeal for the institution to lead you into argument with those, who, through ignorance, may ridicule it. At your leisure hours, that you may improve in Masonic knowledge, you are to converse with well-informed brethren, who will be always as ready to give, as you will be to receive information. Finally, keep sacred and inviolable the mysteries of the order, as these are to distinguish you from the rest of the community, and mark your consequence among Masons. If, in the circle of your acquaintance, you find a person desirous of being initiated into Masonry, be particularly attentive not to commend him, unless you are convinced he will conform to our rules, that the honor, glory, and reputation of the institution may be firmly established, and the world at large convinced of its good effects. The work of the evening being over, I will proceed to give a description of the manner of closing the lodge. It is a very common practice in lodges to close a lodge of entered apprentices, and open a lodge of fellow crafts, and close that, and open a master mason's lodge, all in the same evening. Some brother generally makes a motion that the lodge be closed, it being seconded and carried. The master to the junior, deacon brother junior, giving one rap which calls up both deacons, the first as well as the last care of a mason. Answer? To see the lodge tiled, worshipful. Master to the junior deacon, attend to that part of your duty, and inform the tiler that we are about to close this lodge of entered apprentice masons, and direct him teller accordingly. The junior deacon steps to the door and gives three raps, which are answered by the tiler with three more. The junior deacon then gives one, which is also answered by the tiler by one. The junior deacon then opens the door, delivers his message, and resumes his place in the lodge, and says, "The door is tiled, worshipful." Master to junior deacon, by whom? Answer? By a master mason without the door, armed with the proper implements of his office. Master to junior deacon, his business there. Answer? To keep off all cowards and eavesdroppers, and see that none pass or repass without permission from the chair. Master to junior deacon, your place in the lodge, junior. Answer? At the right hand of the senior warden in the west. Master to junior deacon, your duty there. Answer? To wait on the worshipful master and wardens, act as their proxy in the active duties of the lodge, and take charge of the door. Master to the junior deacon, the senior deacon's place in the lodge. Answer? At the right hand of the worshipful master in the east. Master to senior deacon, your duty there, brother senior. Answer? To wait on the worshipful master and wardens, act as their proxy in the active duties of the lodge, attend to the preparation and introduction of candidates, receive and clothe all visiting brethren. Master to the senior deacon, the secretary's place in the lodge. Answer? At your left hand, worshipful. Master to secretary, your duty there, brother secretary. Answer? Duly to observe the master's will and pleasure, record the proceedings of the lodge, transmit a copy of the same to the Grand Lodge, if required, receive all monies and money bills from the hands of the brethren, pay them over to the treasurer, and take his receipt for the same. Master to the secretary, the treasurer's place in the lodge. Answer? At the right hand of the worshipful master. Master to treasurer, your business there, brother treasurer. Answer? Duly to observe the worshipful master's will and pleasure, receive all monies and money bills from the hands of the secretary, keep a just and accurate account of the same, pay them out by order of the worshipful master and consent of the brethren. Master to the treasurer, the junior warden's place in the lodge. Answer? In the south, worshipful. Master to the junior warden, your business there, brother junior. Answer? As the sun in the south, at high meridian, is the beauty and glory of the day, so stands the junior warden in the south at high 12, the better to observe the time, call the crafts from labor to refreshment, superintend them during the hours thereof, see that none convert the purposes of refreshment into that of excess or intemperance, call them on again in due season, that the worshipful master may have honor, and they pleasure and profit thereby. The master to the junior warden, I wish the reader to take particular notice, that in closing the lodge, the master asks the junior warden as follows. The master's place in the lodge. And in opening he asks the senior warden the same question, the master's place in the lodge. Answer? In the east, worshipful. Master to junior warden, his duty there. Answer? As the sun rises in the east to open and adorn the day, so presides the worshipful master in the east, to open and adorn his lodge, set his crafts to work with good and wholesome laws, or cause the same to be done. Master to the junior warden, the senior warden's place in the lodge. Answer? In the West, worshipful. Master to senior warden, your business there, brother senior. Answer? As the sun sets in the west to close the day, so stands the senior warden in the west to assist the worshipful master in opening and closing the lodge, take care of the jewels and implements, see that none be lost, pay the craft their wages, if any be due, and see that none go away dissatisfied. The master now gives three raps, when all the brethren rise, and the master asks, are you all satisfied? They answer in the affirmative, by giving the due guard. Should the master discover that any declined giving it, inquiry is immediately made why it is so, and if any member is dissatisfied with any part of the proceedings, or with any brother, the subject is immediately investigated. Master to the brethren, attend to giving the signs, as I do, so do you give them downwards, which is by giving the last in opening, first in closing. In closing, on this degree, you first draw your right hand across your throat, as herein before described, and then hold your two hands over each other as before described. This is the method pursued through all the degrees, and when opening on any of the upper degrees, all the signs of all the preceding degrees are given before you give the signs of the degree on which you are opening. This being done, the master proceeds, I now declare this lodge of entered apprentice masons regularly closed in due and ancient form. Brother Junior Warden, please inform Brother Senior Warden, and request him to inform the brethren that it is my will and pleasure that this lodge of entered apprentice masons be now closed, and stand closed until our next regular communication, unless a case or cases of emergency shall require earlier convention, of which every member shall be notified, during which time it is seriously hoped and expected that every brother will demean himself as becomes a free and accepted mason. Junior Warden to Senior Warden, Brother Senior, it is the worshipful master's will and pleasure that this lodge of entered apprentice masons be closed, and stand closed until our next regular communication, unless a case or cases of emergency shall require earlier convention, of which every brother shall be notified, during which time it is seriously hoped and expected that every brother will demean himself as becomes a free and accepted mason. Senior Warden to the Brethren, Brethren, you have heard the worshipful master's will and pleasure as communicated me by Brother Junior, so let it be done. Master to the Junior Warden, Brother Junior, how do Masons meet? Answer? On the level. Master to Senior Warden, how do Masons part? Answer? On the square. Master to the Junior and Senior Wardens, since we meet on the level, Brother Junior, and part on the square, Brother Senior, so let us ever meet and part in the name of the Lord. Here follows a prayer, sometimes used. Master to the Brethren, Brethren, let us pray. Supreme Architect of the Universe, accept our humble praises for the many mercies and blessings which thy bounty has conferred upon us, and especially for this friendly and social intercourse. Pardon, we beseech thee, whatever thou hast seen amiss in us since we have been together, and continue to us thy presence, protection, and blessing. Make us sensible of the renewed obligations we are under to love thee supremely, and to be friendly to each other. May all our irregular passions be subdued, and may we daily increase in faith, hope, and charity, but more especially in that charity which is the bond of peace, and perfection of every virtue. May we so practice thy precepts, that, through the merits of the Redeemer, we may finally obtain thy promises, and find an acceptance through the gates, and into the temple and city of our God. So mote it be. Amen. A benediction, oftener used at closing than the preceding prayer. May the blessings of heaven rest upon us, and all regular masons. May brotherly love prevail, and every moral and social virtue cement us. So mote it be. Amen. After the prayer the following charge ought to be delivered, but it is seldom attended to, in a majority of lodges it is never attended to. Master to brethren, brethren, we are now about to quit this sacred retreat of friendship and virtue, to mix again with the world. Amidst its concerns and employments, forget not the duties which you have heard so frequently inculcated, and so forcibly recommended in this lodge. Remember that around this altar you have promised to befriend and relieve every brother who shall need your assistance. You have promised, in the most friendly manner, to remind him of his errors, and aid a reformation. These generous principles are to extend further, every human being has a claim upon your kind offices. Do good unto all. Recommended more especially to the household of the faithful. Finally, brethren, be ye all of one mind, live in peace, and may the God of love and peace delight to dwell with and bless you. In some lodges, after the charge is delivered, the master says, "Brethren, form on the square." When all the brethren form a circle, and the master, followed by every brother, except in using the words, says, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." At the same moment that the last of these words drops from the master's lips, every member stamps with his right foot on the floor, and at the same instant bring their hands together with equal force, and in such perfect unison with each other, that persons situated so as to hear it, would suppose it the precursor of some dreadful catastrophe. This is called the shock. Having described all the ceremonies and forms appertaining to the opening of a lodge of entered apprentice masons, setting them to work, initiating a candidate, and closing a lodge, I will now proceed to give the lecture on this degree. It is divided into three sections. The lecture is nothing more or less than a recapitulation of the preceding ceremonies and forms by way of question and answer, and fully explains the same. In fact, the ceremonies and forms, generally Masonically called the work, and lecture are so much the same that he who possesses a knowledge of the lectures cannot be destitute of a knowledge of what the ceremonies and forms are. As the ceremonies used in opening and closing are the same in all the degrees, it is thought best to give the whole one insertion, it being the sincere wish of the writer, that every reader should perfectly understand all the formulas of the whole Masonic fabric, as he then will thereby be able to form correct opinions of the propriety or impropriety, advantages or disadvantages of the same. First section of the lecture on the first degree of Masonry. Question. From whence came you as an entered apprentice Mason? Answer. From the Holy Lodge of St. John at Jerusalem. Question. What recommendations do you bring? Answer. Recommendations from the worshipful master, wardens and brethren of that right worshipful lodge, whom greet you. Question. What comest thou hither to do? Answer. To learn to subdue my passions, and improve myself in the secret arts and mysteries of ancient Freemasonry. Question. You are a Mason, then, I presume? Answer. I am. Question. How do you know that you are a Mason? Answer. By being often tried, never denied and willing to be tried again. Question. How shall I know you to be a Mason? Answer. By certain signs, and a token. Question. What are signs? Answer. All right angles, horizontals, and perpendiculars. Question. What is a token? Answer. A certain friendly and brotherly grip whereby one Mason may know another in the dark as well as in the light. Question. Where was you first prepared to be a Mason? Answer. In my heart. Question. Where secondly? Answer. In a room adjacent to the body of a just and lawfully constituted lodge of such. Question. How was you prepared? Answer. By being divested of all metals, neither naked nor clothed, barefoot nor shod, hoodwinked with a cable toe about my neck, in which situation I was conducted to the door of the lodge. Note. Cable toe, 3 miles long. Question. You being hoodwinked, how did you know it to be a door? Answer. By first meeting with resistance and afterwards gaining admission. Question. How did you gain admission? Answer. By 3 distinct knocks from without, answered by the same from within. Question. What was said to you from within? Answer. Who comes there, who comes there, who comes there? Question. Your answer. Answer. A poor blind candidate who has long been desirous of having and receiving a part of the rights and benefits of this worshipful lodge dedicated to God, and held forth to the Holy Order of St. John as all true fellows and brothers have done, who have gone this before me. Question. What further was said to you from within? Answer. I was asked if it was of my own free will and accord I made this request, if I was duly and truly prepared, worthy and well qualified, all of which being answered in the affirmative, I was asked by what further rights I expected to obtain so great a favor or benefit. Question. Your answer. Answer. By being a man, free-born, of lawful age and well recommended. Question. What was then said to you? Answer. I was bid to wait till the worshipful master in the east was made acquainted with my request and his answer returned. Question. After his answer returned, what followed? Answer. I was caused to enter the lodge. Question. How? Answer? On the point of some sharp instrument pressing my naked left breast in the name of the Lord. Question. How was you then disposed of? Answer? I was conducted to the center of the lodge and there caused to kneel for the benefit of a prayer. See page 18. Question. After prayer, what was said to you? Answer. I was asked in whom I put my trust. Question. Your answer. Answer. In God. Question. What followed? Answer. The worshipful master took me by the right hand and said, since in God you put your trust, arise, follow your leader and fear no danger. Question. How was you then disposed of? Answer. I was conducted 3 times regularly around the lodge and halted at the junior warden in the south, where the same questions were asked and answers returned as at the door. Question. How did the junior warden dispose of you? Answer. He ordered me to be conducted to the senior warden in the west, where the same questions were asked and answers returned as before. Question. How did the senior warden dispose of you? Answer. He ordered me to be conducted to the worshipful master in the east, where the same questions were asked and answers returned as before, who likewise demanded of me from whence I came and whither I was traveling. Question. Your answer. Answer. From the west and traveling to the east. Question. Why do you leave the west and travel to the east? Answer. In search of light. Question. How did the worshipful master then dispose of you? Answer. He ordered me to be conducted back to the west from whence I came, and put in care of the senior warden, who taught me how to approach the east, the place of light, by advancing upon one upright regular step to the first step, my feet forming the right angle of an oblong square, my body erect at the altar before the worshipful master. Question. What did the worshipful master do with you? Answer. He made an entered apprentice mason of me. Question. How? Answer. In due form. Question. What was that due form? Answer. My left knee bare bent, my right forming a square, my left hand supporting the Holy Bible, square and compass, I took upon me the solemn oath or obligation of an entered apprentice mason. See page 20. Question. After you had taken your obligation, what was said to you? Answer. I was asked what I most desired. Question. Your answer. Answer. Light. Question. Was you immediately brought to light? Answer. I was. Question. How? Answer. By the direction of the master and assistance of the brethren. Question. What did you first discover after being brought to light? Answer. 3 great lights in Masonry, by the assistance of 3 lesser. Question. What were those 3 great lights in Masonry? Answer. The Holy Bible, square, and compass. Question. How are they explained? Answer. The Holy Bible is given to us as a guide for our faith and practice, the square to square our actions, and the compass to keep us in due bounds with all mankind, but more especially with the brethren. Question. What were those 3 lesser lights? Answer. 3 burning tapers, or candles on candlesticks. Question. What do they represent? Answer. The sun, moon, and master of the lodge. Question. How are they explained? Answer. As the sun rules the day and the moon governs the night, so ought the worshipful master to use his endeavors to rule and govern his lodge with equal regularity, or cause the same to be done. Question. What did you next discover? Answer. The worshipful master approaching me from the east, under the sign and due guard of an entered apprentice mason, who presented me with his right hand in token of brotherly love and esteem, and proceeded to give me the grip and word of an entered apprentice mason, and bid me arise and salute the junior and senior wardens, and convince them that I had been regularly initiated as an entered apprentice mason, and was in possession of the sign, grip, and word. Question. What did you next discover? Answer. The worshipful master a second time approaching me from the east, who presented me with a lambskin or white apron, which he said was an emblem of innocence, and the badge of a mason, that it had been worn by kings, princes, and potentates of the earth, who had never been ashamed to wear it, that it was more honorable than the diadems of kings, or pearls of princesses, when worthily worn, and more ancient than the golden fleece, or Roman eagle, more honorable than the star or garter. or any other order that could be conferred upon me at that time, or any time thereafter, except it be in the body of a just and lawfully constituted lodge of Masons, and bid me carry it to the senior warden in the West, who taught me how to wear it as an entered apprentice Mason. Question. What was you next presented with? Answer. The working tools of an entered apprentice Mason. Question. What were they? Answer. The 24-inch gauge and common gavel. Question. How were they explained? Answer. The 24-inch gauge is an instrument made use of by operative Masons to measure and lay out their work, but we as free and accepted Masons are taught to make use of it for the more noble and glorious purpose of dividing our time. The 24 inches on the gauge are our emblematical of the 24 hours in the day, which we are taught to divide into three equal parts, whereby we find 8 hours for the service of God, and a worthy distressed brother, 8 hours for our usual vocation, and 8 hours for refreshment and sleep. The common gavel is an instrument made use of by operative Masons to break off the corners of rough stones, the better to fit them for the builder's use, but we as free and accepted Masons are taught to make use of it for the more noble and glorious purpose of divesting our hearts and consciences of all the vices and superfluities of life, thereby fitting our minds as lively and living stones for that spiritual building, that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Question. What was you next presented with? Answer. New name. Question. What was that? Answer. Caution. Question. What does it teach? Answer. It teaches me, as I was barely instructed in the rudiments of Masonry, that I should be cautious over all my words and actions, especially when before its enemies. Question. What was you next presented with? Answer. Three precious jewels. Question. What were they? Answer. A listening ear, a silent tongue, and a faithful heart. Question. What do they teach? Answer. A listening ear teaches me to listen to the instruction of the worshipful master, but more especially that I should listen to the calls and cries of a worthy distressed brother. A silent tongue teaches me to be silent in the lodge, that the peace and harmony thereof may not be disturbed, but more especially that I should be silent when before the enemies of Masonry. A faithful heart, that I should be faithful to the instructions of the worshipful master at all times, but more especially that I should be faithful and keep and conceal the secrets of Masonry, and those of a brother, when delivered to me in charge as such, that they may remain as secure and inviolable in my breast, as in his own before communicated to me. Question. What was you next presented with? Answer. Check words 2. Question. What were they? Answer. Truth and union. Question. How explained? Answer. Truth is a divine attribute, and the foundation of every virtue. To be good and true are the first lessons we are taught in Masonry. On this theme we contemplate, and by its dictates endeavor to regulate our conduct. Hence, while influenced by this principle, hypocrisy and deceit are unknown amongst us, sincerity and plain dealing distinguishes us, and the heart and tongue join in promoting each other's welfare, and rejoicing in each other's prosperity. Union is that kind of friendship that ought to appear conspicuous in the conduct of every Mason. It is so closely allied to the divine attribute truth, that he who enjoys the one, is seldom destitute of the other. Should interest, honor, prejudice, or human depravity ever influence you to violate any part of the sacred trust we now repose in you, let these two important words, at the carliest insinuation, teach you to put on the check line of truth, which will infallibly direct you to pursue that straight and narrow path, which ends in the full enjoyment of the Grand Lodge above, where we shall all meet as Masons and members of one family, where all discord on account of religion, politics, or private opinion, shall be unknown and banished from within our walls. Question. What followed? Answer. The worshipful master in the East made a demand of me of something of a metallic kind, which, he said, was not so much on account of its intrinsic value, as that it might be deposited in the archives of the lodge, as a memorial that I had therein been made a Mason. Question. How did the worshipful master then dispose of you? Answer. He ordered me to be conducted out of the lodge and invested of what I had been divested, and returned for further instructions. Question. After you returned, how was you disposed of? Answer. I was conducted to the northeast corner of the lodge, and there caused to stand upright like a man, my feet forming a square, and received a solemn injunction, ever to walk and act uprightly before God and man, and in addition thereto received the following charge. For this charge see page 25. Second section. Question. Why was you divested of all metals when you was made a Mason? Answer. Because Masonry regards no man on account of his worldly wealth or honors, it is therefore the internal, and not the external qualifications that recommends a man to Masons. Question. A second reason. Answer. There was neither the sound of an axe, hammer, or any other metal tool heard at the building of King Solomon's temple. Question. How could so stupendous a fabric be erected without the sound of axe, hammer, or any other metal tool? Answer. All the stones were hewed, squared and numbered in the quarries where they were raised, all the timbers felled and prepared in the forests of Lebanon, and carried down to Joppa on floats, and taken from thence up to Jerusalem and set up with wooden mauls, prepared for that purpose, which, when completed, every part thereof fitted with that exact nicety, that it had more the resemblance of the handy workmanship of the supreme architect of the universe, than of human hands. Question. Why was you neither naked nor clothed? Answer. As I was an object of distress at that time, it was to remind me, if ever I saw a friend, more especially a brother, in a like distressed situation, that I should contribute as liberally to his relief as his situation required, and my abilities would admit, without material injury to myself or family. Question. Why was you neither barefoot nor shod? Answer. It was an ancient Israelitish custom, adopted among Masons, and we read in the Book of Ruth concerning their mode and manner of changing and redeeming, and to confirm all things, a brother plucked of his shoe and gave it to his neighbor, and that was testimony in Israel. This then, therefore, we do in confirmation of a token, and as a pledge of our fidelity, thereby signifying that we will renounce our own will in all things, and become obedient to the laws of our ancient institutions. Question. Why was you hoodwinked? Answer. That my heart might conceive before my eyes beheld the beauties of Masonry. Question. A second reason. Answer. As I was in darkness at that time, it was to remind me that I should keep the whole world so respecting Masonry. Question. Why had you a cable tow about your neck? Answer. In case I had not submitted to the manner and mode of my initiation, that I might have been led out of the lodge without seeing the form and beauties thereof. Question. Why did you give three distinct knocks at the door? Answer. To alarm the lodge, and let the worshipful master, wardens and brethren know that a poor blind candidate prayed admission. Question. What do those three distinct knocks allude to? Answer. A certain passage in scripture wherein it says, Ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. Question. How did you apply this to your then case in Masonry? Answer. I asked the recommendations of a friend to become a Mason, I sought admission through his recommendations and knocked, and the door of Masonry opened unto me. Question. Why was you caused to enter on the point of some sharp instrument pressing your naked left breast in the name of the Lord? Answer. As this was a torture to my flesh, so might the recollection of it ever be to my flesh and conscience if ever I attempted to reveal the secrets of Masonry unlawfully. Question. Why was you conducted to the center of the lodge and there caused to kneel for the benefit of a prayer? Answer. Before entering on this, or any other great and important undertaking, it is highly necessary to implore a blessing from Deity. Question. Why was you asked in whom you put your trust? Answer. Agreeable to the laws of our ancient institution, no atheist could be made a Mason, it was therefore necessary that I should believe in Deity, otherwise, no oath or obligation could bind me. Question. Why did the worshipful master take you by the right hand, and bid you rise, follow your leader, and fear no danger? Answer. As I was in darkness at that time and could neither foresee nor avoid danger, it was to remind me that I was in the hands of an affectionate friend, in whose fidelity I might with safety confide. Question. Why was you conducted three times regularly round the lodge? Answer. That the worshipful master, wardens, and brethren might see that I was duly and truly prepared. Question. Why did you meet with those several obstructions on the way? Answer. This, and every other lodge, is, or ought to be, a true representation of King Solomon's temple, which, when completed, had guards stationed at the east, west and south gates. Question. Why had they guards stationed at those several gates? Answer? To prevent anyone from passing or repassing that was not duly qualified. Question. Why did you kneel on your left knee and not on your right, or both? Answer? The left side has ever been considered the weakest part of the body. It was, therefore, to remind me that that part, I was then taking upon me, was the weakest part of masonry, it being that only of an entered apprentice. Question. Why was your right hand placed on the Holy Bible, square, and compass, and not your left, or both? Answer. The right hand has ever been considered the seat of fidelity, and our ancient brethren worshipped deity under the names of Fides, which has sometimes been represented by two right hands joined together, at others, by two human figures holding each other by the right hand, therefore, we use in this great and important undertaking, to signify, in the strongest manner possible, the sincerity of our intentions in the business we are engaged. Question. Why did the worshipful master present you with a lambskin, or a white apron? Answer. The lambskin has, in all ages, been deemed an emblem of innocence. He, therefore, who wears the lambskin, as a badge of a mason, is thereby continually reminded of that purity of life and rectitude of conduct, which is so essentially necessary to our gaining admission into the celestial lodge above, where the supreme architect of the universe presides. Question. Why did the master make a demand of you of something of a metallic nature? Answer. As I was in a poor and penniless situation at the time, it was to remind me if ever I saw a friend, but more especially a brother, in the like poor and penniless situation, that I should contribute as liberally to his relief as my abilities would admit and his situation required, without injuring myself or family. Question. Why was you conducted to the northeast corner of the lodge, and there caused to stand upright, like a man, your feet forming a square, receiving, at the same time, a solemn charge to walk and act uprightly before God and man? Answer. The first stone, in every Masonic edifice, is or ought to be, placed at the northeast corner, that being the place where an entered apprentice mason receives his first instructions to build his future Masonic edifice upon. Third section. Question. We have been saying a good deal about a lodge. I want to know what constitutes a lodge. Answer. A certain number of free and accepted masons, duly assembled in a room, or place, with the Holy Bible, square, and compass, and other Masonic implements, with a charter from the Grand Lodge empowering them to work. Question. Where did our ancient brethren meet before lodges were erected? Answer. On the highest hills, and in the lowest vales. Question. Why on the highest hills, and in the lowest vales? Answer. The better to guard against cowards and enemies, either ascending or descending, that the brethren might have timely notice of their approach to prevent being surprised. Question. What is the form of your lodge? Answer. An oblong square. Question. How long? Answer. From east to west. Question. How wide? Answer. Between north and south. Question. How high? Answer. From the surface of the earth to the highest heavens. Question. How deep? Answer. From the surface to the center. Question. What supports your lodge? Answer. Three large columns or pillars. Question. What are their names? Answer. Wisdom, strength, and beauty. Question. Why so? Answer. It is necessary there should be wisdom to contrive, strength to support, and beauty to adorn, all great and important undertakings, but more especially this of ours. Question. Has your lodge any covering? Answer. It has, a clouded canopy, or starry-decked heaven, where all good masons hope to arrive. Question. How do you hope to arrive there? Answer. By the assistance of Jacob's ladder. Note. The ladder which Jacob saw, undoubtedly represented the way of life and salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. The rounds in that ladder, the several steps he took in the great work of redemption. The angels of God are sent forth, through this medium, to minister unto them who shall be the heirs of salvation, and not upon the principles of faith, hope, and charity, which are graces wrought in the hearts of Christians by the Holy Spirit. Question. How many principal rounds has it got? Answer. 3. Question. What are their names? Answer. Faith, hope, and charity. Question. What do they teach? Answer. Faith in God, hope in immortality, and charity to all mankind. Question. Has your lodge any furniture? Answer. It has, the Holy Bible, square, and compass. Question. To whom do they belong? Answer. The Bible to God, the square to the master, and the compass to the craft. Question. How explained? Answer. The Bible to God, it being the inestimable gift of God to man, for his instruction to guide him through the rugged paths of life, the square to the master, it being the proper emblem of his office, the compass to the craft, by a due attention to which, we are taught to limit our desires, curb our ambition, subdue our irregular appetites, and keep our passions and prejudices in due bounds with all mankind, but more especially with the brethren. Question. Has your lodge any ornaments? Answer. It has, the mosaic, or checkered pavement, the indented tessel, that beautiful tessellated border which surrounds it, with the blazing star in the center. Question. What do they represent? Answer. The mosaic, or checkered pavement, represents this world, which, though checkered over with good and evil, yet brethren may walk together thereon and not stumble. The indented tessel, with the blazing star in the center, the manifold blessings and comforts with which we are surrounded in this life, but more especially, those which we hope to enjoy hereafter, the blazing star, that prudence which ought to appear conspicuous in the conduct of every Mason, but more especially, commemorative of the star which appeared in the east, to guide the wise men to Bethlehem, to proclaim the birth and the presence of the Son of God. Question. Has your lodge any lights? Answer. It has, 3. Question. How are they situated? Answer. East, west, and south. Question. Has it none in the north? Answer. It has not. Question. Why so? Answer. Because this, and every other lodge, is, or ought to be, a true representation of King Solomon's temple, which was situated north of the ecliptic, the sun and moon, therefore, darting their rays from the south, no light was to be expected from the north, we, therefore, Masonically, term the north a place of darkness. Question. Has your lodge any jewels? Answer. It has, 6, 3 movable and 3 immovable. Question. What are the 3 movable jewels? Answer. The square, level, and plumb. Question. What do they teach? Answer. The square, morality, the level, equality, and the plumb, rectitude of life and conduct. Question. What are the 3 immovable jewels? Answer. The rough ashlar, the perfect ashlar, and the trestle board. Question. What are they? Answer. The rough ashlar is a stone in its rough and natural state, the perfect ashlar is also a stone made ready by the working tools of the fellow craft, to be adjusted in the building, and the trestle board is for the master workman to draw his plans and designs upon. Question. What do they represent? Answer. The rough ashlar represents man in his rude and imperfect state by nature, the perfect ashlar also represents man in that state of perfection to which we all hope to arrive, by means of a virtuous life, and education, our own endeavors and the blessing of God. In erecting our temporal building, we pursue the plans and designs laid down by the master workman on his trestle board, but, in erecting our spiritual building, we pursue the plans and designs laid down by the supreme geometrician of the universe in the Book of Life, which we, Masonically, term our spiritual trestle board. Question. Who did you serve? Answer. My master. Question. How long? Answer. 6 days. Question. What did you serve him with? Answer. Freedom, fervency, and zeal. Question. What do they represent? Answer. Chalk, charcoal, and earth. Question. Why so? Answer. There is nothing freer than chalk, the slightest touch of which leaves a trace behind, nothing more fervent than heated charcoal, it will melt the most obdurate metals, nothing more zealous than the earth to bring forth. Question. How is your lodge situated? Answer. Due east and west. Question. Why so? Answer. Because the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. Question. A second reason. Answer. The gospel was first preached in the east, and is spreading to the west. Question. A third reason. Answer. The liberal arts and sciences began in the East, and are extending to the West. Question. A fourth reason? Answer. Because all the churches and chapels are, or ought to be, so situated. Question. Why are all churches and chapels so situated? Answer. Because King Solomon's temple was so situated. Question. Why was King Solomon's temple so situated? Answer. Because Moses, after conducting the children of Israel through the Red Sea, by divine command, erected a tabernacle to God, and placed it due east and west, which was to commemorate, to the latest posterity, that miraculous east wind that wrought their mighty deliverance, and this was an exact model of Solomon's temple, since which time, every well-regulated and governed lodges, or ought to be, so situated. Question. To whom did our ancient brethren dedicate their lodges? Answer. To King Solomon. Question. Why so? Answer. Because King Solomon was our most ancient Grand Master. Question. To whom do modern Masons dedicate their lodges? Answer. To Saint John the Baptist, and Saint John the Evangelist. Question. Why so? Answer. Because they were the two most ancient Christian patrons of Masonry, and, since their time, in every well-regulated and governed lodge, there has been a certain point within a circle, which circle is bounded on the east and the west by two perpendicular parallel lines, representing the anniversary of Saint John the Baptist, and Saint John the Evangelist, who were two perfect parallels, as well in Masonry as Christianity, on the vertex of which rests the Book of the Holy Scriptures. Supporting Jacob's ladder, which is said to reach to the watery clouds, and, in passing round this circle, we naturally touch on both these perpendicular parallel lines, as well as the Book of the Holy Scriptures, and while a Mason keeps himself thus circumscribed, he cannot materially err. Thus ends the first degree of Masonry, and the reader, who has read and paid attention to it, knows more of Masonry than any entered apprentice in Christendom, and more of this degree than 100th part of the Master Masons, or even Royal Archmasons, for very few ever attempt to learn the lectures, or even the obligations, they merely receive the degrees, and there stop, with the exception of a few who are fascinated with the idea of holding an office. They sometimes endeavor to qualify themselves to discharge the duties which devolve on them in their respective offices. The offices of secretary and treasurer are, by some, considered the most important in the lodge, particularly where there is much business done.